Welcome, 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 geeks and nerds, girls and boys, to a brand new edition of Geek to Me Radio. Today, we will engage in part two of our conversation with writer DG Chichester, talking more about his epic run on Daredevil. We'll also talk about a Kickstarter project he's got in the works, all that and more, so stand by.
We're talking TV, comics and movies, and video games. Star Trek from Star Wars, we'll try to explain. There are 12 doctors, 4 Hogwarts houses, 1 ring rules and more. To be the greatest Pokemon master, you must catch them all. You must catch them all. Try to catch them all. Gotta catch.
And for those of you who might be tuning in, this is your first episode, welcome. This is part two of our talk with DG Chichester. And if you didn't get part one, you can always go back to wherever you get your podcasts from. We have all of our episodes archived on places like Stitcher, iTunes, Podomatic. Wherever you get your podcast from, you can find us there. Just type Geek to Me Radio and you can catch up on part one of this, along with a lot of our other great interviews that we've had. But this is part two of our talk with writer DG Chichester, talking a little bit about his run on Daredevil and more. Let's get into it.
We've been at it for about 40 minutes. Are you okay? I don't want to take up too much of your morning. If you need to wrap it up soon.
No. You tell me what you want to talk about. I'm yours for, you haven't cut me off at 10 minutes, so it's at least interesting enough for you to keep talking. So hit what you want.
I'm here for you. I love, like I said, this is why I kind of started the show, because I get to fanboy out and actually talk to the people who did all these work on people who I love, the, like I said, Terror and Daredevil and everything like that. I'm a huge fan, so this is great for me.
Thank you.
That's one of the reasons I started the radio show, so it's kind of helpful in that respect. Just kind of seeing what we didn't. Oh, so working on Acclaim Bloodshot. I know you got to work on that title. How did you find the movie? Did you like, it's not like you had a huge run on Bloodshot, but you had an imprint on it. You worked on the character. How did you find the movie?
You know, I have not seen the movie.
Okay.
It's one of the ones I haven't gotten to. Probably if it had been in the theaters, I would have taken in a matinee or hit it up. And because I assume it's on streaming.
It should be by now. Yeah.
I haven't grabbed hold of it. I think when it came out, did it get into the theaters?
I do the press screenings, and it came out literally the week before they announced the lockdown for COVID. So I think it may have had a small opening weekend, and then that was it. So I feel bad for, obviously probably would have done better in the theaters had it not been yanked so quickly.
Right. I remember seeing the previews and the trailers and saying, okay, this looks pretty cool. And I do like Vin, and we don't have to cry for Vin Diesel because he's got umpteen billions of dollars.
Sure.
But, there's something appealing about him as an actor and a performer, and yet he can't seem to catch a break in terms of creating another franchise character, right? It's all Fast or Furious or nothing. I love the hell out of the Pitch Black things and kept hoping that, that Riddick character would take off more, but it just seems like it's a passion project for him. Mm-hmm. But I definitely have to check out Bloodshot and see how it is. And as you said, my influence there and involvement was very limited. If I remember correctly, it was, I think, literally two issues. And those were two issues, I'm remembering correctly, that I scripted, right? It was an instance, because I was known to the Acclaim guys from having worked more on the Magic the Gathering and the Sliders work, I think the plots had been done, the art was done, the writer, for whatever reason, wasn't able to finish the scripting. Mm-hmm. So they called me in to say, here's the plot, write the script. So you have to be familiar with the character and enjoy the whole time, but it's a little different than when you're creating the whole storyline.
Yeah.
You're writing words around somebody else's story, and you're hopefully trying to be respectful to what they did and say, I think this is where you're going, as opposed to playing some game of Mad Libs where you're writing dialogue that has nothing to do with, with the original plot, which people have done too. So
And then Sliders too, we mentioned, which I was a huge fan of that show. If I'm trying to remember, was the comic concurrent with the series or did it come out after the series had ended? I'm trying to remember now time wise how that worked.
The series was still running.
Okay.
It might've been, a season in, or maybe not quite the full season in, and the comic, you know, had come out, around that time and then continued to run while the series was going on. So I remember, early on, the series was already out cause I was familiar with it. Acclaim contacted me, pretty sure it was Jeff Gomez, who was the editor on it at that point. And we did have a couple, at least one or two conversations with Tracy Torme, who was the creator and executive producer of it, about what is the series about, where were some of your influences, you know, where are some of the places we can go with this. And it was always a series of series, right? It wasn't an ongoing Slider series. It was a 3-issue bulk here. It was a 4-issue bulk here. So while I got to write quite a few of them, everyone was also an audition. You know, there was a proposal and there was, here's where the storyline will go. And then there were other ones in between there. I think Jerry, what's the actor's name? Jerry O'Donnell. Jerry O'Donnell, you know, who's the main character. I think he wrote a one-off, issue. And I think there was another spin-off of something. And then toward the end of that, I remember pitching two more, at their request. One was a completely original story. And then one would have been pretty amazing, which was a Quantum Leap Sliders crossover.
Oh, that would have been brilliant.
Which I wish I still had the proposal for, cause I remember writing it and saying, this is going to be pretty cool. Cause I was a big fan of Quantum Leap.
Yeah.
And you know, you think about the whole idea of alternate dimensions and whatever was going on in Quantum Leap and how that could possibly like create a collision of characters and events.
That'd been very cool. And then of course we've got John Rhys-Davies Sliders, and he also played Kingpin. So you've got that connection there too.
That's true. That would have been, I didn't even think of that. Yeah. And I mean, that was one of the things that first got me into the TV show on Sliders, was just enjoying him as a performer within the geek cult fan type of projects that he's always been involved in. Such a terrific performer in his own way. You know, he's one of those guys clearly who raises the game on whatever he's in.
Absolutely.
He's had the opportunity, obviously, to be in things that have influenced us all. So when I saw, okay, this guy's the character here, that was probably what turned me toward the show as much as just the idea of alternate worlds. And, and you could really channel him when you were writing the character in the comic quite a bit.
And circling it back to Daredevil, with I know you brought Typhoid Mary into the mix, brought her back. You mentioned in other interviews I've seen that you kind of feel like Daredevil never gets the love that he deserves from Marvel. Was that kind of a chip on your shoulder going in when you took the book? Or did you kind of want to elevate it, much like Peter David did with the Hulk? Was it kind of like, this needs to be a higher profile thing? What was your mindset going into taking on Daredevil, bringing in Typhoid Mary, the Fall of the Kingpin storyline?
Mm-hmm.
Was this all something you had laid out? And how far in advance do you have these ideas in mind going into starting the book?
We're going to pause right there, take our first break, come back and continue our conversation. So please stand by.
Hey, man, it's me, Kevin Smith, Silent Bob. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio, man. This is the only radio show that the guy does Batman Beyond listens to for his geek news.
Welcome back to Geek to Me Radio. I am your host, James Enstall. Continuing our chat with writer D.G. Chichester. Before we took that last break, we were asking him about his mindset going into beginning his run on Daredevil.
No, it's a great question. Getting into that book was another unusual circumstance. I've been very lucky and fortunate for the right things at the right time. So when I got the Daredevil assignment, I wasn't, maybe I never was A-list. I always looked at myself as I was a good B-list performer. I'm dating myself now, but I always said, I'm a good Brian Dennehy, you know,
love Brian
Dennehy. I'm a good, I do too. And, So I was, you know, I'd written a bunch of different range of things, fill-in issues, and probably at that point, the thing I was best known for was a run on S.H.I.E.L.D. I was writing Nick Fury and S.H.I.E.L.D. at that point and having a great time with that. I was a big James Bond fan, and boy, I get to write a super spy, and how much more fun can you possibly have? And I remember being home with my parents at Thanksgiving, and I got a call from Steve Busolato, who was my assistant editor at one point, then was my editor on those Shadowline books, and we had been friends for a while. And he said, Ann Nesenti's leaving Daredevil. You should try for the book. And I was like, what do you mean I should try for the book? It's Daredevil. You know, I'm like, I'm writing Thundercats fill-ins and, you know, and epic stuff and, you know, S.H.I.E.L.D. and those type of things. I'm not ready for Daredevil. And he said, Ralph, who's Ralph Macchio, who's the editor, really likes your stuff. And he did, you know, I talked to Ralph on a bunch of different things and you should just try it. So in a way, you know, I called Ralph and I said, listen, I understand Ann's leaving. Ann was a big deal. Ann had a great run and a very Ann-like run, exploring really new and unusual areas for Daredevil beyond, say, Frank Miller's very hard-boiled, you know, approach. And I said, listen, could I take a swing at the book? And Ralph was very respectful and sort of said, listen, I like your stuff. Happy to give you a go. But it was kind of one of those, listen, it's Daredevil.
Yeah.
Everybody's gonna try for this. So I said, okay. But kind of like that jihad story I told you a little while ago, I remember sitting down and writing that proposal. And it's one of the few things I still have a scan or a printout on because I had this horrible hard drive crash back in 2001, 2002. And I lost almost every digital, you know, copy of plots and scripts and things that I'd ever had. So kids, backup.
Yeah.
But I sat down and it just sort of flowed out of me that initial, here's what I would do for Daredevil. And it really started on two concepts. You know, one was that the city was a character and that the neighborhoods that he was occupying were kind of characters and we should use the richness of New York because he loves New York. And the other was it's time to take down the Kingpin. And because the friction of those scenes, you know, where he would go in and say, if you cross this line again, you know, Wilson, you know, it's over for you. Oh, just you try it, you know, Daredevil, and back and forth there, they had become useless because every issue, every storyline kind of had that scene and you can't continue with that to my mind. So I just said, let's take down the Kingpin. Let's really take down the Kingpin. Let's get him out. Let's take him and then let's put him out of the picture for a while. Let's let him rest for whatever few months or whatever, and then bring him back in a different, more raw form. And that was kind of the initial thinking. And that tonality was what brought it. And then when Ralph amazingly called me and said, great, you got it. Then I had to figure it out. Right. Then I had to get into knowing that and I came in at that point when we were probably 8 or 10 issues out from 300. So Lee Weeks was the artist who had been assigned. I was the writer who had gotten the gig. Lee and I sort of knew each other, but, you know, we'd become much better friends and collaborators as we began to work on this. And so knowing that we wanted to lead into 300 with this big, the Kingpin's taken down, we had a couple of, I won't say filler issues, but, you know, we had some initial issues that we needed to kind of ramp up around. So the Punisher was in one, I think, and a couple of other things. Yes, but then we knew, right. So we knew this was going to be a four issue story that would land on 300. So that's when I needed to really kind of sit down and start to think about, okay, how do you take down the Kingpin? What do you have to do? And that was another moment of how do you start to draw from things that have been established. Characters like Typhoid Mary, you know, elements there that you can then, you know, put to work. And there was a rawness to writing it because I didn't have any compunction about it. That whole scene with Typhoid Mary, where he sleeps with her to screw with her head. I mean, that was an uncautious moment as a writer.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it was spot on. And it was the dark side, the daring side of Daredevil to do that, to manipulate things, to put it in a place of, I am going to go and I am going to manipulate the city and the people and pull my levers of power to create this whole machination that would normally be the sort of thing that that the kingpin would arrange, right? So there was a dark side to that whole thing. So a lot of that just kind of came in a really raw and unfiltered way, which I wish I could have maintained more of, because I think after that I became, even going back and rereading that original proposal, and you said how much has worked out there. There were beats, but there were things that I didn't. There were also beats. Okay, well now we're going to do this with Daredevil. We're going to do this with the Kingpin, that I forgot about, air quotes, you know, or didn't pull through. And maybe that was me becoming more cautious as a writer. You know, oh, now I'm on Daredevil. Now this got some good attention. We had some good sales. What do I do with this character now? How do we work with this? And I think you're most powerful and authentic as a creator, and this is what I try to remind myself of later on, is when you're in that uncautious space, when those moments just kind of come to you, like that typhoid scene, like that, the whole way even Fury takes down Daredevil in that storyline. You know, it's sort of like, I know who you are. We've got things that kill your hypersenses. We have this foam stuff that's going to just trap you. So stop your tricks. We've got this under control.
Yeah.
You know, there were moments that just sort of felt very natural. Mm-hmm. And you don't filter yourself as much, and you allow yourself to explore it with the knowledge that you have about the character, with the knowledge that you have from maybe other research that you do. So that came, you know, together in a nice way. And then your other part of the question was, I guess, like, you know, chip on my shoulder. I didn't have a chip on my shoulder going in. You know, I just wanted to write a good story and tell a good tale. The chip came later, when we probably got into the fall from grace time, because that was where, at that point in time, and now it's a different world. I'm not familiar with all the things, and Daredevil seems like he has a better position. But at that point, everything was, if it wasn't a spider or a mutant, it wasn't getting a lot of love, right? Or better yet, a spider who is a mutant, right?
Yeah.
At one point, weren't they trying to do that? And let's get all the worlds together, the X spider. And the only time that Daredevil got attention was when Frank Miller came back on it. And I'm not putting myself at Frank Miller's level, make no mistake on that. But as I said to Ralph and I said to the promotional department, I said, you're doing yourself a disservice, because at one point they came out with an ad, and I remember bringing it into the promotion guys, and Ralph and Frank was writing, I guess it was Daredevil year one, probably at that point, maybe.
Yeah, I think so.
And the ad was, it's Miller time, you know, and that was the ad. It's Miller time. And I said, well, A, it's ripping off a beer ad, which I don't know if that makes a lot of sense. But also, you're saying the only time this character has value is when Frank Miller comes and plays with it. And I'm not trying to say promote my stuff in the same way, but you should be thinking about the character as the character. We've proven with some of these events with Last Rites or the Fall of the Kingpin, with Fall from Grace, which was, you know, event driven but was doing well, that we can get some boost behind this character with the right combination of things. So there was definitely a feeling of a chip on the shoulder there, and before I was unceremoniously fired from the book, the plans were to create a kind of a Daredevil subuniverse. I mean, Ralph and I were actually sketching out a little, you know, corner box treatment that would represent, when you see this on the book, it's a Daredevil universe book. And we probably had about, I want to say, three or four Daredevil projects sketched out. Mm-hmm. One was the ongoing book. One was, there was a sort of a Daredevil year two that I don't remember a lot of details around right now. There was a weird but interesting time travel story where Daredevil was going to get thrown back to kind of Boss Tweed time. Boss Tweed was a sort of a Kingpin like character who actually ran New York City back in the 18, whatever,
like Tammany Hall kind of a thing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So we had Paul Ryan was going to be the artist on that. And I had actually sketched out like the proposal on that. So there was almost like this Daredevil mini universe that we were going to say, things are going to, there's going to be a lot of activity around this beyond just the main book. And we're going to promote the hell out of this. And everybody kind of seemed interested and on board and jazzed about that kind of approach, which took the chip off my shoulder a little bit.
Yeah.
Because I felt like, okay, now we've pushed past that. We're owning the situation. But then those plans went away.
Yeah. That time travel, I remember reading that you had wanted to do something like that. And I think that would have been so much fun to see. Anytime you take a character out of their normal surroundings and put them someplace alien, that's always makes for some incredible storytelling.
We'll pause right there, take another break, come back, continue our talk with the epic writer, D.G. Chichester. Please stand by.
Hey, this is Mark Guggenheim, and you are listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Welcome back to Geek to Me Radio. The show would not be possible without the support of our sponsors, of course, and our premier sponsor, been with us from the beginning. We've always talked about it, the Convention and Visitors Bureau of St. Charles. Then the website, as you well know, is discoverstcharles.com. Discover St. Charles. Just went over there this week and was looking into how things are proceeding for their Legends and Lanterns event coming up. It's going to look a little different than it has in years past because of COVID. They're taking steps to make sure that everyone will be safe. The characters will be wearing masks, obviously, but masks also to help prevent the spread of COVID. Socially distanced, they'll be spread out in different ways. So it's going to be a unique festival. If you've been to it in the past, and I understand not everyone's ready to come out and do stuff in the public arena, and I get that. But if you are, they are taking extra steps to make sure that you and your family will be safe, as well as all the people participating and bringing you the festival. They'll be safe as well. You can get more information about the festival itself, Legends and Lanterns, as well as some other things there are to see and do while you're in St. Charles, all on the website. Once again, that site is discoverstcharles.com, discoverstcharles.com for, as we say here, an historically good time. Before we went to break, we were chatting with writer D.G. Chichester. This is part two of our two-part interview. And we were talking about he had an idea of putting Daredevil into a time travel position, and we were kind of discussing that story.
Yeah, and thanks for saying that. And one of the things I was planning, I remember, you know, playing out with that was, as I said before, one of my big interests was Daredevil's senses. So this is a guy who's lived his whole life in New York City, except for that weird trip to San Francisco. And and he knows the senses and the smells and the sounds of New York so well, right? It's what gives him part of his power. So suddenly you dump him into a New York that has none of the senses that he's used to, right? All the smells would be different. All the sounds would be different. Everything would be alien to him. How cool would that have been to play that out as at a hypersense level, you know, not just overloading him, which it certainly would have done, but also, how does he then adjust to that? And what does he learn or not learn as he goes along? And then, of course, how does he figure out how to get back to his own time? And I think we had some angles on that. Probably Nikolai Tesla was in there somewhere. I don't know. I knew how he went back in time. I don't think I'd quite figured out how he came forward in time.
And I know nowadays you're not really doing much comic book writing. You've got a completely different, I wouldn't say completely different life, but you're in advertising, I believe, with a large firm. So do you miss it? Do you kind of wish that, I'd like to kind of dip my toe back in? Have you ever been approached by any of the people, Marvel, DC, Valiant, anybody to come back and do stuff?
Yeah, I do. And I'll tell you about, you know, kind of what I'm up to, along those lines. I made a foolish and kind of, but conscious choice at a certain point when I got into advertising or had the chance to kind of get into advertising, because as the comics market kind of collapsed, which it did right in the mid-90s, there were less opportunities. It was harder to kind of knock on the doors, even the ones that you used to be able to knock on were tough for everybody, not just for me, you know, hardly. And, And I sort of felt very black and white at that time. And I don't, in retrospect, that was probably a silly mentality, but I sort of said, well, if I have to pound on this door that I've already been in the party on, or I have to pound on some new doors that I've never been invited on, you know what? I'm going to double pound on the new doors. Cause clearly why should I give these guys the time of day over here? If they're closing the door on me, I should be respected. I should be whatever. And I should have kept my hand in both. You know, there was no reason that when the door opened on advertising and I got some opportunities there and I was able to build out that I couldn't have kept more in touch with people or said, well, what about a side project? What about this? What about that? Or what about exploring things? And I know I definitely undermined that part of myself and my familiarity with that world. Not that there would have necessarily even been an assignment, because there were plenty of people fully committed to that and fully committed to that world. But I definitely shut off part of that for a while. And the comics, work in between hasn't really been very active, like writing an intro for that Nightbreed collection, you know, I mentioned before. So, you know, as I said, I kind of cut myself off probably from exploring opportunities. But right now, and over the last, year plus, maybe almost 2 years now at this point, I reconnected with an artist friend of mine, Carl Waller, who I'd done some work at Dark Horse on a short run book for their universe called Motorhead. And it was part of their shared universe, and their shared universe didn't take off in a big way. But Carl and I had a good rhythm, you know, good collaboration, a lot of good conversations. And there was a story that he had, not a story, there was an idea that he had thrown out at one point. And it was a kind of a assembly of different pieces. It's like, you know, what if there were these truckers and these, you know, there was probably some strippers involved, and there was, it was a whole host of stuff. And I kind of remember nodding along and sort of saying, yeah, okay, Carl, that's interesting. You know, I don't know what to do with it, but, you know, I'll give it a thought and we'll see. And maybe there is something again to that automatic writing, you know, I've been talking about, because I went away and came back to Carl with this idea, and I wrote it, you know, almost straight out. I don't think I really went back and revised it, which I probably should have. It's probably too wordy, but it was taking what he had done, what he had sort of thrown out as just an eclectic assembly of sort of scenes and bits. And it developed into this idea of sort of interdimensional afterlives and, you know, the damnations of different cultures. You know, what does it mean to be damned if you're Christian? And what does it mean to be damned if you're Irish? And what does it mean to be damned if you're Viking? And all these different sort of horrific afterlives, you know, across history. And what if they had a kind of a delivery service, you know, that had to deliver damnation, you know, to different people? And who would be involved with that? And who would the truckers be? And why would they be involved? And what would their sort of adventures be in sort of the working class, you know, for these bigger than life situations? A lot more to it. But anyway, we started a riff on this idea and even tried to pitch it at one point in a way that wasn't a great pitch. It was actually the thing that sort of drove me out of comics, probably as much as that black and white thing, because I remember trying to get a particular editor on the phone. And I had been an editor for a long time. So I think, oh, okay, you know, I'm going to respect another editor the way I'd like to be respected. And so I had kept trying to call this editor and call this editor and call this editor and say, listen, I have a proposal with Carl. I think it's pretty cool. I think it'd be great for your imprint. And would you be willing to take a look at it? You know, I just didn't want to send it in cold. Yeah. I wanted to sort of respect the guy's time. Which is what I had always recommended to people. And finally, never got any callback. And I remember late one night getting this guy, and I could tell right away he was sorry he'd picked the phone up. You know, he clearly had expected somebody else, right? And I did my quick, spiel. I said, you know, listen, you know, hey, you know, so-and-so, I've got this idea. I think it's perfect for the imprint. Carl and I have been working together. We've got some, you know, character sketches, some sample pages. We've got a whole proposal. Is it cool if I send it in to you? And, you know, you can't commit to anything, I realize, but you just want to make sure that it's good by you, that you'll take a look at it. Yeah, sure. Do that. I'm thinking to myself, great, you know, here's Ariane. This is the thing we've been looking for. I'm just about to hang the phone up and, you know, say, thanks. You know, be out in a few days. And he's like, who are you again? And exactly. And as I said, I wasn't full of myself, but I was full of myself enough to sort of feel like, wait a minute. When I was an editor, I knew pretty much everybody who was working, even not working or sort of working, you know, at least by name. And maybe it was a bit of an ego and a bit of hubris on my part, but that was definitely part of the feeling of like, you know what, if I got to pound on this door in this kind of way and scratch at this door and, you know, my nails are getting all bloody and whatever, it's not fun.
Yeah.
And so kind of walked away from that situation, never sent it into that guy. And the project kind of went away, you know, but Carl and I sort of went in different directions, you know, now and again, and in touch. But anyway, we reconnected not too long ago. And the first thing we both said to each other was, hey, you remember that thing? And it was really weird. And it, that had stayed in our heads all that time. It had definitely kept coming back into my head. It had kept coming back into his head. And I become a fan of this idea that ideas are things, you know, that they are almost, genie like things that are kind of out there.
Yeah.
And they visit themselves upon you, and your responsibility is you have to make something out of it. And if you don't, they're going to go off and they're going to visit somebody else. And that person is going to be smart enough to do something with it.
Hmm.
And then suddenly your idea is going to become real through somebody else's writing or creation or whatever. So I said to Carl, this thing came to us many years ago, you know, 20 years ago, almost, you know, really in reality, it stayed with us for a reason. We've reconnected for a reason. If we don't do something with it now, it is going to finally say, I've had enough of you guys. And, and I'm really going to go somewhere else. I've given you more than enough time. So we've actually been really diligently working on this thing. I've rewritten parts of the proposal. I've actually written the first 5-issue story arc.
Oh, wow.
Carl is beginning to illustrate it. He's got character illustrations. We just hired a logo designer to create a logo for us, and we're putting together that as a package, which we're going to approach a couple of publishers with, if probably not that guy that I called many years ago.
Yeah.
And who would even more now say, who are you? And if that doesn't pick up, you know, then we're also mapping out a Kickstarter plan to you know, finance it. I just feel it's a unique idea. It still feels valid as I got into writing it. It felt you know, once the muscles started working in that way, it felt very natural, and the story surprised me, you know, and even as I wrote it. And I said to Carl, I'm kind of glad in a way that we didn't write it back then or didn't put it together back then. I'm probably lying to myself. It would have been great to do it then. But but I think the tools I would have used then would have been my more expected bag of tricks, like
sure,
where my headspace was, where my talent space was. I would have, okay, insert chase scene here. All right, insert. I don't think I was a by the numbers sort of writer, but you always have something on your whatever you're in your toolbox,
right,
that you sort of reach for. And my toolbox is different now. So even as I was writing this, where the story kind of took me, I let it take me. Sort of maybe that what I was saying before about the Typhoid Mary thing. These moments felt very authentic, and I was surprised by where the story was opening up and where it was going along the way. So, you know, more to come on that. But it feels like it's something that, you know, wherever it takes us, it will be a comic story of its own right and have its own life, which is a fun place to be.
And there's a lot of people who have found, I mean, even like currently established working writers and authors and artists, Kickstarter's been huge. I know Jimmy Palmiotti and Amanda Connor, They do a lot of those Kickstarters, and they've had great success. I know I had Rick Burchett talking with him, and he and Greg Rucker are doing a Kickstarter for one of their things. Mm-hmm. So that's a great avenue to go down. So
absolutely.
If you go down that route, let me know, because I always try to back projects like that. So I'd love to help you out.
We're going to take another quick break, come right back, and continue our talk with writer D.G. Chichester. So please stand by.
Hey, you guys, this is Raphael of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And after we've kicked Shredder's butt, we all get down in the sewer and we listen to Geek to Me Radio. Turtle power!
Welcome back to Geek to Me Radio. We are wrapping up our conversation with writer D.G. Chichester talking. We've covered a lot of ground. Like I said, this is part two of a two-part episode. And if you missed the first part and you're this far along, you may as well just continue. If you want to go back and catch up on the second part, you can go to wherever you get your podcasts from, be it Stitcher, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Player FM, Podomatic, and check out part one of the interview as well. And all of our other back catalog, we always encourage you to do that. You can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Geek to Me Radio. We always post new shows there and on our Facebook page, facebook.com/Geek to Me Radio. Before we took our last break, we were chatting with him about an idea for a Kickstarter he has.
I absolutely will. Yeah, I think it's a business unto itself. And by that, I mean, it's you have to. And that's what I'm, you know, mapping out now with Carl, too. If we go down that road, you have to approach, this is what you're doing for your launch. This is what you're doing for your marketing around it. This is what you're doing in terms of your budget around it. It's not a money machine where it's like, oh, look, I put a project on Kickstarter.
Yeah.
You know, where's my money coming? And the biggest thing to think about something like that, if that's where it goes, is it's a value exchange, right? I'm not asking for your money. I'm not just asking you to invest in this. We're going to create something. We're going to mutually sort of exchange something on this, which is a terrific thing to do.
Yeah.
You're connecting people who are interested in the work that you're creating. And I think that's probably as much as anything why you see established creators, as well as folks just wanting to kind of get going on stuff, being able to use a space like that. It takes work.
Yeah.
And I think that's the biggest trick as a creator of anything. There's always a part of you that always just wants to be, can I just do the work? can I just create and let the work speak for itself? And maybe that's never been possible, but I think it was probably a little bit more expected back in the day where you would write a comic, you'd illustrate a comic, and then a big publisher would take care of all the promotion,
yeah,
take care of it, because you're working on their property or something, or within their world. You know, nowadays you have to factor in, well, if something like that happens, that's great, but I gotta play it up. I've gotta be part of the social marketing engineering network around it to do that. So, all good stuff, and definitely will keep you up to date as that happens.
Very cool. And as we're wrapping things up here, obviously you're working on that. Let people know where they can find you: website, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. Where can people find you if they want to learn more about you, what you're doing, projects you've done, new stuff you've got coming out?
Yeah, I mean, I would definitely check me out on. And it's not very active right now, but I'm going to ramp it more up. I mean, my website is just an informational website, but I may add more there, which is capitalistfiction.com, CAPITALIST fiction.com, which is more right now just sort of a portfolio site for my work overall. But I may be adding some more stuff to there. But probably the best place for folks to contact me is Twitter, which is just DG Chichester. And I'm semi-active there, and that's how you and I, you know, connect.
Yeah.
It. And always happy to connect with folks or answer questions or get into a thread about whatever. And as I start to figure out, not just for marketing this new thing, but overall thinking about how we communicate some of this, there'll definitely be more activity on there and Instagram and such.
Very cool. This has been fantastic. Like I said, I'm a fan of your work.
It's always
great to connect with artists and authors and people who have put a lot of their time and effort into these titles that I've enjoyed so much, and kind of pick your brain a little bit. So thank you for your time.
Well, thank you. This has been terrific, and you took us into some new places of questions, so I had to think for a change, you know, so I appreciate your you know, the interest and also the way you sort of approached it.
No,
really
absolutely. Absolutely. Continued success. Hopefully, if this thing project takes off, I might see you once COVID's over at a convention. I'll have you sign my Terror Incorporated promo poster.
I would love that. I'll see if I may still have a Terror Incorporated stickers. I don't know if you ever got one of those.
I didn't, no.
I may still have one or two if I can find one. And there's some stickiness left to it. I'll let you know and send it your way.
I appreciate that. That'd be very cool. Thanks so much.
There was a Terror. You have to show. Send me a shot of the Terror Incorporated poster. I don't even know if I have one of those.
I'll have to take a look because I know, like, I just had the last one I had signed before I had it framed was the Spider-Man Kraven's Last Hunt, the black and white promo poster.
Right.
The last signature I needed was Mark DeMatteis, and I saw him at a convention in Richmond. He goes, I didn't even know they made this. So I actually ended up tracking one down for him on eBay. Just by chance, I happen to see another one, but I'll see if I can, because I've got a stack of ones that are not signed nor framed yet. That's probably this big. So I'll have to dig through it and see if I can find it.
Yeah, I have some things from like the Night Stalkers, you know, stuff. I know I have some things from the Shadow Line. I don't know if I have a Terror Incorporated poster. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I think I've got the big Shadow Line poster because I think that had St. George and it had some of the other titles underneath with everybody listed. So that's another one I'll have to have you sign. You'll be my first signature on that because I just got that off eBay like last week.
Oh, that's awesome. You could also, if you ever see Fabian Nicieza at a convention, he wrote the ad line for that.
Oh.
So that would be, you know, just so you know, like, you know, our world is their world. They want it back. So I remember he was the author of that line. So he has a direct connection to that poster, if nothing else.
I just had him sign a bunch of stuff at, I guess it was GalaxyCon Louisville was the last time I saw him in November. So I'll have to bring that along because I think I had him sign everything else I had for him to sign. But that'll be a nice little.
He may not even remember writing that line, but I remember him writing it. So awesome.
Very cool. Yeah, well, thanks again for your time. I hope I didn't take up too much of your morning, but this is it's always great. Like I said, once I get on a roll, I could probably talk to you for another hour or so, but I'll leave it there. That was a good stopping point, I think.
Good. Hope you got some good stuff out of it, and I look forward to the whole listen when you put it together. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Have a good rest of the morning.
Take care, James. Be
you
well.
Too. Bye.
Bye-bye.
And that's going to do it. My thanks again to writer D.G. Chichester. Just a fabulous guy. We spent a lot of time chatting, and that's why I wanted to make sure this was a two-part interview, because he had so much to say, and I didn't want to do my audience the disservice of trying to cut out parts and fit it into one episode. So this is a rare two-parter for Geek to Me Radio. We're going to take our last break, come back, and just kind of wrap up some stuff, do a little bit of house cleaning, so please stand by.
Hi, this is Lauren Lester, the voice of Nightwing, and you're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Welcome back to our last segment here on episode 187 of Geek to Me Radio. I'm your host, James Enstall. I want to make sure we mention our other sponsor, Marcus Theaters, marcustheaters.com. Theaters are starting to open up again. I can almost hear a choir of angels singing. Russell Crowe in Unhinged will be one of the movies you get to see, as well as Tenet, finally coming out from the mind of Christopher Nolan. Lots of things going on. New Mutants. This, assuming that doesn't get pushed back at the last minute, New Mutants is finally out in theaters. It got postponed like five times. You can see New Mutants. They've got a lot of stuff. If you're not ready to come out of your house yet and see movies in the theater, they are doing some other things that you can do. And they've got like their curbside pickup happening Wednesday, August 26th. You get a ginormous bag of popcorn, a free movie pass, and some other goodies. You just go ahead and order it on the website, marcustheaters.com. Swing by your local Marcus and pick it up. And through September 30th, you can fill your popcorn bucket for free. So if you get one of those popcorn buckets, it's good for the rest of August and the entire month of September. Just fill that up when you go in. Very excited to go back and see movies. I, of course, will be wearing my mask as is required. They're doing limited capacity, so the seats will be harder to come by. But then again, a lot of people might not want to come out, and that's okay. Not everyone needs to rush out and see movies. But if you are going to see it, if you are going to go out and you're missing that movie experience like I've been, do it at a Marcus Theaters. MarcusTheaters.com is the website. Find out which ones by you are open and where you can go get your tickets online, all that good stuff. Marcus theaters.com. DC Fandome happened this past weekend. That was a huge success. I was riveted, spent a lot of time watching all the panels. Great, fantastic programming. So kudos to Jim Lee, the people at DC Comics, and the people at Warner Brothers. We got to see Wonder Woman 84. We got to see the Batman. We got to see James Gunn's Suicide Squad. Obviously not the whole movies, but the previews. But it was brilliant. I loved it. I was very excited to see Dennis Cowan, Phil LaMarr, and company there to talk about the relaunch of Milestone, which is fabulous. I'm anxious to, I know Dennis is obviously very excited for Hardware. A lot of us excited to see Static Shock. And I want to hear more about that Static Shock movie that they have in development. A lot of cool things happening over there. And I want to just thank you all for kind of who tweeted along with me for that giveaway. Thanks to Marcus Theaters. Thanks to Warner Brothers that we did this past Sunday. It was great to do that and give that unboxing away. You can go check out the unboxing on Facebook.com/GeekToMeRadio. And you can also check out Instagram, GeekToMeRadio, and Twitter at GeekToMeRadio. We encourage you to keep up with us. Follow us there. I love doing this. I love talking to these authors and these writers and these creators and these celebrities that I get to talk to. It's why I do the show. I love talking to these people. And hopefully, if you've been listening this long, you also enjoy the conversations and the interviews that I've brought you. So make sure you connect with me. Let me know what you like about the show. If there's something you don't like, please handle it gingerly. Let me know without bruising my ego too badly. You can, like I said, tweet at me, at GeekToMeRadio. Send me an email, James@geektomeradio.com. Let me know what your thoughts were on DC Fandome and virtual cons in general. Thank you, as always, to Joey V, not only for all the great audio stuff that he brings and makes the show sound as good as it does, but for filming that unboxing video. He had a full professional setup thing. So if you out there are looking for someone for doing sound editing, or if you're local to the St. Louis area, some video work, he's got a drone, he's got all this high-tech equipment, you can reach out to me, James@GeekToMeRadio, and I will put you in contact with Joey. He would love to help you as well. That's going to do it for another episode of Geek to Me Radio. We will catch up with you next week. So until then, my friends.
It's not in the way you watch I sound be. It's not in the way you watch the Flash. It's not in the way you love Scotty Young Art. It's not in the way you play Mario Kart. It's not in the way you look when you make Game of Thrones references. That's a show. This is Geek Tube. That's a show.
Thank you, Hell's Kitchen. Good night.
Hi, this is James Enstall, host of Geek to Me Radio, and in honor of my favorite Themyscirian, I've decided to become an Amazon warrior.
Hera, give me strength.
The next time you want to buy something from Amazon, go to geektomeradio.com first and click on our Amazon affiliate link. Simply shop like you normally would, and when you check out, a small percentage will go towards supporting the show. So remember, the next time you want to search Amazon for the latest Wonder Woman graphic novel or parts for your invisible jet, click through from geektomeradio.com first.
The world was in peril. Would you have me stand by and do nothing?